I guess it's still early in the morning, and I expect many more people to stream in as the day goes by. But what better way to spend an election day than talking about crypto and obfuscation? So definitely much more interesting than listening to the news. All right, so welcome to the Dimax CEF workshop on crypto and software obfuscation. I think all of you know we have this Bay Area Crypto Day that we run like twice a year. And so this time we decided to merge this workshop with the Bay Area Crypto Day, and we'll resume the regular Bay Area Crypto Day programming in 6 months. I think it's bayareacrypto.com is where that's hosted. All right, so if anyone wants access to the Wi-Fi, just use Stanford Visitor. It's open to the public, and you just have to click on accept, and you can get started. All right, so first of all, I guess we need to thank our sponsors. So lunch will be provided, and parking was free and all that, and that's all thanks to the sponsors for the workshop. Also, I should say the videos for the, I think we were supposed to be recording. I hope we are recording. We are recording, awesome, yes. Thank you. So the videos from all the talks will be posted up on the conference, on the workshop webpage after we're done. And the reason we're able to do all that is because of all our sponsors. So the first is the NSF Center for Encrypted Functionalities, CEF. This is a collaboration among five or six or seven universities now, many universities working on making obfuscation closer, bringing obfuscation closer to reality. It's a five-year NSF Center, a large effort. I think we are, two years into it? So we got 3 years to make it work. And you're going to hear about all the progress today. And the other one is Dimax. Dimax, of course, is centered at Rutgers. They do a lot of wonderful work in generally in theory of computer science, and they had a special focus on crypto. And instead of forcing everyone to fly out to the East Coast, we are able to hold one of the workshops here. And Amit is actually one of the you're on the organizing board, steering committee of the special focus on crypto. All right. And as I said, videos will be available on the workshop website. Speakers, if you want to put your make your PowerPoint slides available, just give them to me or email them to me, and I'll put them up on the workshop website so everyone can have them. So I think the Berkeley folks are still slowly. Anyone from Berkeley here? Ah, okay, one, just one. Okay, they're slowly streaming in. But I do want to say there's an organizing committee for the Bay Area Crypto Day. So it's myself, Ali from Berkeley, Juan from Yahoo, and Sanjam also from Berkeley. Like we said, we put these programs together twice a year. And then for this workshop, also, of course, Amit and Rebecca Wright helped with everything. So thanks to the steering committee. If you see them during the break, thank everyone for putting this all together. Hope it'll be a fun day. And as usual, I have to be a good host. So while everyone, before we get started, I have, I guess, a few more minutes to just do the intros. So before we get started, a few fun things you can do on campus. So during the break, if you want to take a tour, it's a wonderful, beautiful campus to walk around. So we're down here at Encina Hall. You can orient yourself based on the tower. So the tower is right next to us and the oval. So if you want to see some nice things during the breaks, one thing you can do is you can actually just walk across the oval to the Stanford Museum. There's a large Rodin sculpture garden, which is very pretty to visit. So that's a nice thing to do over lunch, either today or tomorrow. If you want, you can go up the Hoover Tower. It's open to the public. You can see all of Silicon Valley from the top of the tower. It's actually worthwhile doing at least once in your life. And then if you're into books, you can walk over to the bookstore. It's pretty close. And you can see, these things, old things called books. All right, and I guess in case you're wondering, this is where the computer science building is. So we're kind of across campus. It's a bit of a walk to get to computer science, but if you want to meet anyone in computer science, that's where we are. Last thing I'll say is I want to tell you a little bit about the security activities at Stanford. So lots and lots is happening at Stanford. The main thing is if you go to the Computer Security Seminar website, you can sign up for our mailing list. And the reason to sign up for the mailing list is you get notified about events like this. Yes? So it's a very low volume list. I hope everyone has already signed up. If not, please visit the security site and sign up. If you'd like to speak at the security seminar, just send me mail and we can organize that. And of course, we have lots of courses and all sorts of other activities, but I'll skip that. All right. So today we're going to have, the program's going to run for 2 days. We're going to run until noon. Lunch will be served in the room over there, and we can kind of eat around the building. It's a nice building that we can spread out in. If you want a breakout area, if you want to hang out with someone and just chat, it's best to go downstairs and just go one floor down, and there are sofas in the basement that you can sit on. The program will run until around 5 both days, and should be a great, fun thing to do. And as we said, lunch will be served outside. So enjoy the program, have fun, and I'm really looking forward to hearing everyone's results. So with that, let's get the show on the road. And our first speaker is going to tell us on how to build obfuscation, right? So here, let's disconnect this, and we can connect it to your laptop. Get started.
Be walking.
You need to bring it down to 720p.
Sorry?
Bring the rest down to 720p.
Oh, okay. So thanks for inviting me, and so I have to apologize first because I'm quite ill, so my voice is not so great and might get worse. Also apologize if you were at TCC because there are some stuff that were also already presented there. So today I'm going to talk about the power of secret key function encryption, and this is a joint work with Nir, Rio, and Daniel. So let me start with very basic stuff, and let me start with public key encryption. So as probably all of you know, in public key encryption, what we know is what we can do is any user that is given the public key can encrypt a message, and the owner of the secret key can decrypt the message and recover the plain text X. And for security, what we ask is just that given without knowing the secret key, then encryption of a message X should be indistinguishable from an encryption of a message Y. So as you see, it's all or nothing primitive. So either you don't know the secret key and you don't learn anything about the message, either you know the secret key and you learn the plain message. And so what we'd like in the real world is to be able to do something that is a bit more refined, that we would like to be able to reveal partial information about the messages. So this gives rise to the notion of functional encryption. And in functional encryption, we have now the possibility of derive functional secret keys. And given a functional secret key for a function f, you are able to compute f of x given an encryption of a message x. And of course, now two encryptions cannot be indistinguishable as soon as the image by f are distinct. But what we ask for security is that if f of x is equal to f of y, then the encryption of X should be computationally indistinguishable from the encryption of Y. So this is in the public key setting, and of course it makes sense in the private key setting. The only difference is now that you need the secret key to encrypt. So as I already said, the purpose of this talk and of this paper is to explore the power of secret key functional encryption. And before going further, let me clarify something. I will talk a lot about functional encryption, FE, and stuff. And I want to make clear that when I say FE, I mean that the encryption, the complexity of the encryption encryption circuit is independent of the size of the function and of the number of functional secret keys. Otherwise, I will just call it weak functional encryption or weak FE. Okay, so. As I said at first, the purpose of this paper is to explore the power of secret key functional encryption. And in particular, we want to understand how far functional encryption, secret key functional encryption can lead us. And to illustrate that, I'm going to use the world, the complexity world introduced by Russo Limpagliazzo. So as you probably all of you know, there were two words introduced by Russo and Impagliazzo a few decades ago now. And the first word is called minicrypt. And it's the world in which we have just one-way function. So in this world, we can build like pseudorandom function or pseudorandom generators or just symmetric encryption. And the minicrypt can be seen as like the home of modern crypto. In minicrypt, we feel very safe. We can do some stuff, not so many stuff, but we are quite sure that this is secure. But at some point, you get bored and you want to do some stuff that you cannot do in minicrypt. So you want to go outside, and to go outside, you need extra assumption and you need to be brave enough. And once you go outside, you discover a whole new world, which is cryptomania. And in this world, you can have like public key encryption. And if you go a bit around in this world, you discover that you can do a lot of amazing stuff, such as public encryption, of course, but also fully homomorphic encryption, or attribute-based encryption, predicate encryption, and a lot of amazing stuff. So these were the two words introduced by Russell a few decades ago. And the recent works in crypto, you're all aware of that because you're here today, I've shown that there might be actually a whole universe to explore outside these two worlds. And this universe is a place where we have indistinguishability obfuscation. So, and as recent works have shown, we have plenty of amazing stuff that we can discover in this universe. And the only question that remains is how can we go there? So regarding functional encryption, we recent results have shown that some form of functional encryption allows us to go there. And actually what we know for functional encryption is that weak versions of functional encryption are actually not that powerful, because weak SKFE is in minicrypt and weak PKFE is in cryptomania. This is thanks to the work by Amit and Akshay in 2010. And what we know is that thanks to work by Vinod and Nir and by Paranjan and Abhishek, that full-fledged public key functional encryption can give us obfuscation. So actually what I'm not saying here is that we need sub-exponential security, but let's just say that PKFE leads us to obfuscation. So the question we want to answer here is that is the place of SKFE in these three worlds? And actually it's a real question, because we have we don't have much ideas about the place of SKFE, and we have some contradictory results. The first result is that SKFE might even be weaker than PK, and this is because of a work by Asharov and Segev last year, which showed that even sub-exponentially secure SKFE cannot give you public key encryption if you just consider black box reduction. And so this might lead us to think that SKFE is even weaker than PKE. But on the other hand, we don't know any construction of SKFE that is not itself a construction of PKFE. So actually, all the construction we know are already lead us already in obfuscation, to obfuscation. So the question is real, and we partially answer this question in this work, and we do the following. So we start with any SKFE scheme and any plain public key encryption scheme, and we show that given these two tools, then it's enough to build public key functional encryption. And then if you have assume also sub-exponential security of the two primitives, then you can build I/O. So in terms of the illustration I drew before, what it gives us is that if you are in cryptomania, then if you have SKFE, it's good enough to go and explore Obfuscopia. So that's it for the introduction. So now let me give you some ideas about the techniques that are involved in our work, and let me start with the something that is a bit recurring in the recent works in obfuscation, and the fact that everything is about the size actually, and this is pretty clear in the recent works. All we care about is compactness or compression or succinctness or any terms you want a very broad intuition for the reason we care about compactness is the following. So if you have a circuit, see that any circuit you want to obfuscate. A very simple way to obfuscate this circuit is just to output its truth table. So it's this perfect indistinguishability obfuscation. It's perfectly secure, but the problem is that the size of this truth table is just way too big. So very rough intuition. So it's really an intuition, so don't cite me on that. But the intuition is that you can if you can split this this circuit into small circuits that are easy to obfuscate, and you can compose all this obfuscation, then maybe the then using the compression you can avoid the blow up and build the obfuscation for the general circuit. So this is the broad idea for the reason we care about compactness. And a very good example for that is the power of exponentially efficient I/O, or XIO. So unfortunately, Raphael was supposed to talk about that, but he couldn't come today. So I'm going to try to explain it very briefly. So XIO is just somehow a very inefficient I/O scheme. And what do I mean by very inefficient? Let's say you have a circuit C that takes as input bit string slot length n. So in the rectangle here is the truth table of this circuit. So up to some factor, it's of size 2 to the n. And what's an XIO of this circuit? An XIO is just an obfuscator that's going to build a functionally equivalent circuit, C tilde. And the only requirement that we ask is that the size of this obfuscated circuit is polynomial in the side of the original circuit, but up to some huge factor, and this factor can be almost the size of the truth table. It has just to be slightly smaller than the size of the truth table, so it's up to some factor 2 to the n to the 1 minus epsilon. And actually, what's a bit surprising maybe is that even if you have just constant compression, so epsilon equal omega of 1, then actually it's already good enough to build public key functional encryption and then I/O. So this is a result by Lin et al. This year at PKC, and what they show is that XIO plus LWE implies public key functional encryption and then implies I/O assuming sub-exponential security. So let me try to give you a sketch of the reason for that. And let me clarify two things. So the first thing is why do I use LWE? The LWE is just stands for single key succinct public key functional encryption for Boolean functions. So you have a functional encryption scheme that allows you to derive one single function, functional secret keys. And this is for a function that outputs a single bit. And what do they build is public key functional encryption. Actually, you just need to build a single key sublinear public key functional encryption for a polynomial size circuit. So let me explain how do they achieve that. So what you want to do is just to provide some encryption of a message f of a message m that is slightly sublinear in the side of the function. And after, you want to be able to evaluate a function that is a that can be a multi-bit output function. So a very simple solution to do that is just to encrypt a message mi, where I are all the components of the output, and to provide functional secret key for a decomposable function that just output the ith bit of the output of the function, so the ith bit of f of m. So the reason it doesn't work, of course, is that if you do that, you encrypt the size of the output message, so more or less size of the function message, and it's not good enough. So the ID is still pretty good, actually, because on the right side, you still have a Boolean function, so that's what you want. You have a functional encryption scheme for Boolean function, so that's something you can derive using the PKFE scheme you have. But what you want is to compress the part on the left-hand side. So let me do this differently. The idea that is actually good enough to work is just to decompose the computation on the left. And you're just going to compute a circuit C that has the message R coded in it and takes as input a component of the a component I and output the encryption of M and I. And then you still feed it to your functional script key and you get the ith bit of the output F of M. So this is the decomposition of the computation you want to do, and now you just XIO this stuff, and as the input is in the size of the domain has a size of the output, it's the XIO has a size that is sublinear in the size of the output, which is sublinear in the size of the function. So this is good enough, and so basically what we have done here is just doing decomposition and the XIO of the decomposition. So this is something we are going to use a lot in our work, actually, with in the SKFE work. And so this is something that will come later also. And now the security is actually almost immediate. What happens is you change the message. If f of m is equal to f of m prime, then the security immediately follows from the security of the PKFE scheme, PKFE for Boolean functions. So more or less, this is what happens in the XIO paper, and now we are going to use this XIO paper a lot. So this already gives you, as already explained, public key function encryption from XIO plus LWE. And actually, what we do in this paper, in our paper, is to build PKFE from a different path, and we do it in two steps. So the first step is to build XIO from SKFE. And then this already gives you a public key function encryption from SKFE and LWE. So this is directly applying the previous papers. And the second step is to remove this LWE dependency. And what we do is to we replace the LWE dependency with just plain public key encryption. And actually, how do we do this? We just build the public key function encryption from Boolean function that was previously used using public key encryption and XIO. I'm going to come to that later. So which gives us the main result of our paper is to build the PKFE from SKFE and plain public key encryption. So in particular, with only the first step, you might think that LWE is a strong assumption. So maybe it's not the power doesn't come from SKFE. But now you can do also a PKFE from SKFE and the public encryption based on DDH, for instance. And I hope that DDH is good enough to build a PKFE. So let me start with the first step now. So I'm going to explain how to build XIO from SKFE, and actually this is fairly simple construction. So let's consider a circuit C that takes as input bit string dot length n, and let's just say that the output is a single bit. So as I already said earlier in the introduction, a very good indistinguishability obfuscation for this circuit is just to output the truth table of the circuit. The problem with that is the side of the truth table, which is of size 2 to the n. So we don't want to do that. We just want to do something that is slightly smaller than 2 to the n, because we just target XIO and not IO. So how are we going to do that? So the basic idea is to split the input into two bit strings of length n over 2. So now you can see the truth table as being indexed by bit strings of length n over 2. So this is a square table of size 2 to the n over 2. And we want to build this XIO from SKFE. So what we have, what we can use is just encryption and functional secret keys. So a very basic idea is to just provide encryption of every bit strings of length n over 2 X and the functional security for this circuit that takes bit strings of length n over 2 and evaluate the circuit C on fixed bit strings of length n over 2. So this allows you to evaluate the circuit on any point. You can compute C of X concatenate with Y combining the corresponding encryption and functional secret keys. And the size is good enough also for XIO, because the size is just poly of C and times 2 to the n over 2. So this is good enough. The problem is security with that. If you have two functionally equivalent circuits, you want the XIO to be computationally indistinguishable. And the problem here is that all the information about the circuit is in the secret key, functional secret key, which doesn't hide anything. So basically, what we want to do is just to reverse the construction, and you're going to encrypt the circuit, and you are going to give a functional secret key for a universal circuit. That's on input program P, just evaluate this program on a fixed bit strings. So now this still allows you to evaluate the circuits everywhere, and the security immediately follows from the security of the SKFE scheme. And the reason is just that if you change the circuit to a new circuit C prime that is functionally equivalent, then the circuit the decryption of the ciphertext are just the same everywhere. So that's it. That we have built XIO with the compression 1/2 from SKFE. And this gives you the first result, which is given XIO and given SKFE, you can build a public key functional encryption and then IO using just LWE. So now let's try to get rid of this LWE assumption. And as I said earlier, this LWE assumption does come from the fact that we need a single key succinct PKFE from Boolean functions. So what we do as a second step is just to build this single key succinct PKFE for Boolean function from XIO, which we already have from SKFE, and from plain public key encryption. And once we are done with that, then we have public key functional encryption from SKFE and plain public key encryption, and which is what we want to do. So let me describe the construction. The construction is actually fairly simple. So basically, we take the weak PKFE construction from PKE, which has an encryption circuit whose complexity is proportional to the size of the functions, and we are going to build something that is just a bit less weak using XIO. And what do I mean by less weak? Is just that the encryption circuit has now a complexity which is sublinear in the size of the function, but that also depends on the depth of the function. But this is good enough to build public key functional encryption. So this is what I want to do. So let me start with the weak PKFE from PKE scheme. And basically what we want to do is more or less just using universal circuits. So why that? So let's say you have a universal, so I recall a universal circuit, it's a circuit that takes as input a description of a function f, and also a description of a message m. And once you evaluate the circuit on these inputs, then you are able to build to compute f of m. So more or less, what you want to do is to provide an encryption that is a universal circuit for a message m, and functional circuit keys that are inputs for this universal circuit that allows you to evaluate any function f on the message m. So sorry. So this is more or less the idea of the weak PKFE construction. The problem with this construction is that, of course, the message is not hidden. So what we want to do is just to use garbled circuits. So what you are going to do is to garble this universal circuit for the message M. And now, of course, the inputs for this garbled circuit are the labels of the garbled circuit. And the problem is that now you need interaction if you want to evaluate a function, because you need to give the correct labels corresponding to the functional circuit keys. So to have this interaction, what you are going to do is just to encrypt all these labels using some public keys, and this is going to be your encryption of a message M. So encryption of a message M is just going to be an encryption of the garbled circuit and the encryption of the input labels according to some public keys. And now the functional secret key is just going to be the secret key corresponding to the public keys, so that if you are given a functional secret keys, you are able to decrypt only the labels corresponding to your function, and you are able to evaluate your function on the message M. So this is the construction by Amit and so Akshay, I think. Akan, oh sorry, I say Akshay earlier. Yeah, Akan, sorry. So it's a nice construction, but the problem is that it's not good enough for what we want to do, because the side of this encryption circuit is proportional to the side of the function, because even just the public key is proportional to the side of the function, and we also need a garbled circuit which is even bigger. So. Okay, but what is fine is the functional secret keys. Functional secret key is just a set of secret keys of size side of the function, but we don't care. It's good enough for what we want to do. So I'm not going to change the functional secret keys. The functional secret keys are just going to be secret keys for a public encryption. And now I'm just going to reduce this the encryption, the side of the encryption circuit. So we can see this as doing we can split this in two different steps. So the first step is a circuit garbler, more or less, the thing that will output the garbled circuit. And the second step is the input garbler that will output the encrypted labels. So the good news is that garbling circuits is a process that is very local and that is decomposable. So actually, there is a very small circuit that allows you to garble circuits gate by gate, and this circuit is just going to take as input the decryption of a gate of a circuit, and will output the corresponding garbled gate. Of course, there is some stuff hidden in this box CG, so the local garbled circuit garbler. So what you want to do is just to hide this stuff, and the best thing to hide stuff is using I/O. So, but we don't have I/O, but we have X/I/O. And actually, what I claim is that X/I/O will be good enough because the size of the gates will be the size of the universal circuits. And I'm going to come back later to that, but we can make it work to be sublinear in the size of the function. So this is for the circuit garbler, and now what we want to do, of course, is the same thing for the left-hand side. So you want to provide a local input garbler that takes as input an index of a label and a bit, and output the corresponding label. The problem here is that you want the label to be encrypted. So the problem is that here you have the public key, and the public key is huge. So if you X/I/O this circuit, you obtain something that is huge because the public key is already huge. So what you want to do before that, you want to reduce the size of the public key, and we're still going to do the same thing since the beginning of this talk. What we just do is decompose and the X/I/O. So for the public key, we are going to do the same thing. We are going to X/I/O a key generator that takes as input the I and the index and the bits, and that will output the corresponding public key for this index and this bit. And now you replace the public key in this X/I/O, and this public key is smaller, and I claim also that it works. This requires a bit more work. So, but basically what we have done is just decompose all the process and X/I/O this decomposition. And what I claim is that this new circuit, which is just a garbled circuit that is decomposed and X/I/O, is sublinear in the side of the function. So at this point, you might say it doesn't work, because the problem is that what I said is that X/I/O is just something that is just slightly sublinear in the side of the truth table. So I just claim that X/I/O is 2 to the n to the 1 minus epsilon. And here in the previous slide, what I did is an X/I/O of an X/I/O. So this is not, this clearly, if you don't have precise parameters, this doesn't work, because you X/I/O something that is already an X/I/O, so the size of all this will be just too big. Actually, I didn't give you the complete description of the X/I/O we can build. So what I gave you, so I claim that if you have good enough X/I/O, we can do it, because if you have good enough X/I/O with good enough compression, then you can compose you can avoid the blow-up that comes from the fact that you X/I/O and X/I/O. And actually, the real X/I/O construction we give in our paper is an X/I/O that is 1 over t compressing for any constant t, so for any t equal big O of 1. And how do we do that? It's just we use the construction that allows you to go from single input SKFE to multi-input SKFE. for any so for single input SKFE to T input SKFE for any T for any constant T. And this is a result by Zvika, Ilan, and Guild of this year at Eurocrypt. And the reason for that is the following. So let me recall you how we built XIO. So I told you that you can do XIO with 1/2 compression using a single input SKFE scheme. And the reason for that is just that you are going to give to split the input into two bit strings of length n/2. And you're going to give functional security for the first half and ciphertext for the second half. So you have 2^n/2 functional secret keys, 2^n/2 ciphertext, and the overall size is 2^n/2 times poly of C. sorry. So what I claim now is that if you have two input SKFE, then you can just do this one more time and just add 2^n/3. So now you split the input into three bit strings of length n/3 instead of two bit strings of length n/2. And now you give 2^n/3 functional secret keys and 2 × 2^n/2 functional ciphertext. And this also gives you an XIO, but now this XIO is 1/3 compressing. And then if you use the BKS paper, you can build XIO, which is an XIO which is of size T times 2^n/T. So an XIO which is 1/T compressing for any constant T. And actually, if you have that now, then it's good enough to overcome the problem of XIO of obfuscating an XIO. So sorry. So the last thing we need to argue, of course, is the security, as always, always the problem. So security is not that straightforward, actually. So for the reason for the security for to be not that straightforward is the following. What we have is for an encryption of a message M, what we have is just some decomposable garbled algorithm, let's say. So you have something that outputs garbled gate or garbled inputs. And if you want you'd like to argue that if you have two messages M and M prime, such that F of M is equal to F of M prime, then these two ciphertexts, so these two XIO actually, are computationally indistinguishable. And if you want to rely on the XIO security, it doesn't work because to rely on XIO security, you want circuits that are computationally equivalent. And this is not the case here. You have just circuits that are whose outputs are computationally indistinguishable. So using XIO security is not good enough. And actually, it's something that is quite subtle. The proof is quite subtle. And actually, how do we achieve the proof of security? We rely on the indistinguishability of the decomposable garbling scheme. And this is something that is actually not really new, but that is a bit subtle. And the problem actually comes from the fact that you want to compress the hybrids in the garbled circuit security proof, the garbled circuit hybrids. And you want the problem is that as you're using some kind of IO, I mean it's XIO, but let's consider it as some kind of IO. You want all the intermediate hybrids that you're going to use to have all the same size because you don't have security guarantees if the circuits don't have the same size. And the problem with that is that in your hybrid, you may need to you may require a lot of memory to store some intermediate stuff that you are using to do your hybrids for garbled circuits. And then if this memory you use is too big, then you have a problem because the IO is not the functional encryption scheme is not efficient enough. So this is somehow related to the problem of encountered in success randomizer coding. And there is a solution that is provided in the paper by Nir and Sanjam, Rachel, Raphael, and Siddharth, I think. At Fox 2015, but so in this paper they explain how to achieve that But the memory they need is the width of the function. And for us, it's not good enough, because the width of the function will be the side of the function, and can be as big as the side of the function, and we want to something that is sublinear in the side of the function. So this first attempt doesn't work, and other works in this area actually doesn't work either, because it works with I/O but not with X/I/O. So I don't give details about that, but that's the high level idea. So actually, the solution comes from a recent work by Daniel with some other people that appeared at Crypto this year, and this is the work about adaptive garbled circuits. And thanks to this work, we are able to build this using only a depth time size of the output memory. And sorry. So here you might say that's not good enough still, because the size of the output could be big. And actually, what I claim is that the size of the output is not a problem, because what you can do is to just what we do actually in the paper, and it requires an additional step. We do it first for single bit output functions. And after you do something, some kind of XIO gymnastic, more or less the same as the LPST paper, so the first XIO paper. And using this, you can go from single bit output to multi-bit output. But this requires another step that I'm not going to describe here. So, okay, so this is really the subtle part. I recommend you to have a look at the paper if you want more details. Let me summarize what I've said so far. So the first step I described is an XIO from SKFE, and as I already said, using the LPST paper, this XIO from SKFE already gives you IO from SKFE plus LWE. So the second step I just explained is how to remove the LWE dependency. And to do that, we use a plain public key encryption and XIO. And this leads us to the main result of the paper, which is public key functional encryption from SKFE and plain public key encryption. So now you might ask, why do we need public key encryption? This seems like, as it's just any plain public key encryption, this seems very weak primitive, and we'd like to get rid of that. But so far, I don't know how to do that. And actually, it's a real question. And let me now discuss a bit about can we remove or can't we remove public key encryption? And actually, there is two different answers. I already give you a brief taste of that. The first answer is no, we cannot. And the reason is because of the Asharov-Segev paper, which says that SKFE is not good enough to build a PKE. The problem with this result is that it's an impossibility result for black box construction, and we have seen so far that impossibility result for black box construction in obfuscation doesn't really make sense. I mean, they make sense, but doesn't really apply in general, actually, because a lot of transformations are actually not black box in the IO world. And so this result even holds with sub-exponentially SKFE schemes. And I don't clarify here, but what do they mean by black box construction here is that the functional secret keys cannot itself apply the encryption circuits. So you cannot derive. It's not black box for them if your functional secret keys allows you to encrypt using the underlying SKFE scheme. So this is the negative part. But on the other hand, actually, what we show in this work is that you might be able to get rid of the PKE assumption. And what we do in this paper is that we build public key encryption from sub-exponentially secure SKFE and one-way functions. And the problem is that the PKE scheme we built is not good enough to lead us to IO, because it's only quasi-polynomially secure. which is a bit unsatisfying. And so we cannot have a sub-exponentially secure PKE using our construction. And so we cannot go to I/O without public encryption. And of course, these results are not contradictory. It's just that our transform is not a black box because we use the BKS paper, because we need a very compressing XIO, and the BKS paper is in itself non-black box. So as I have like 1 minute more, I can give you a very brief intuition about the PKE scheme that we built. Actually, it's a very simple and actually quite elegant scheme, I think. And it's very similar to the witness encryption scheme. More or less, what we do is just that to encrypt, we just use a PRG, and you use an XIO of a circuit that's verified that your seed corresponds to the evaluation of the PRG, and if it corresponds, then you decrypt the message. I mean, it's not maybe not clear, but okay, we can discuss it offline if you want. So that's it, and thank you once again. So yeah, I still don't know actually.
So that's a big challenge now.
Yeah, we still don't know. So if I had to guess, I would say that. So the problem is that we still require the PKE thing. So we don't know if SKF is enough Utopia because we need the PKE thing. If I had to guess, I would say that we can remove the PKE dependency because I'm pretty sure you can build PKE from SKF. The question is how do you do that? I don't really know. So actually, I've tried with different people to get rid of the PKE in the construction, or building even different construction without PKE, and it didn't work. But I think the best way to do that is to build directly PKE from SKFE. And I think actually a good guess, I guess that's the last thing I didn't try yet that comes to my mind actually. It's to improve the BKS paper to get a better. The reason that we don't have a sub-exponentially secure security and just quasi-polynomial security is that the BKS paper only allows you to go from a single input to a constant number of inputs, and you'd like to do something more. And if you can get rid of that, you can do much more. But so maybe it's a good. I mean, this immediately implies that, but I don't know how to do it.
Yeah. I guess that would have lots of implications.
Yeah, I guess so.
Great. Any other questions? All right. Well, in that case, thanks a lot. Let's take a quick break, actually. Oh, yeah. Okay.